Hi, my name is Dean. I'm an alcoholic and an addict, and this is Inside Addiction. Things first today, we do have a studio audience who will be taking questions from them at the end of the show. So why am I doing Inside Addiction? I'm 34 years old. I've struggled with addiction for half of my life. I was a disc jockey for 12 years. I got caught up in the nightlife and the bar scene. After 15 years of active alcohol and drug addiction, I got help. Now I think it's my turn to give back, pay it forward. I want to be part of the solution just as long as I was part of the problem. So today, I hope to start a 15-year series about alcohol, drug addiction, treatment, and recovery called Inside Addiction. My first guest and co-host today is Ken Seeley, founder of Intervention 911. He's also an on-air host and interventionist for the A&E series Intervention. He's a preferred interventionist for the Betty Ford Center, has been on CBS The Early Show, CNN, Larry King Live, Fox News, Entertainment Tonight, MSNBC, and is one of the most sought-after interventionists in the country. Please welcome Ken to the show.
Thank you.
Thanks for joining us, Ken. Ken, why don't you tell us what you do?
What I'm gifted to do is I'm able to work with families and get their loved ones into treatment when their loved ones are in denial and don't want to go to treatment. And you could use that for many different avenues. It's not only for drugs and alcohol, but I just did an intervention on OCD.
Okay.
So there's many ways to intervene on somebody's life that when they're doing some harmful behaviors that you see that they need help in, but yet they're in denial, we step in as professionals and we help them get the help that they need.
Okay. Do interventions work? Do you actually know the percentage of your success rate?
Yeah, interventions are very successful. What we do is we have like 80 to 90% go right after the letter format of the intervention, and then the other like 10% go after, you know, the consequences. I don't like to call them consequences. I like to call them healthy boundaries or you know, a lot of people like to call them ultimatum consequences. We call them healthy boundaries. They're the things that the family decides to do to raise the bottom, because no addict ever stops until they hit a bottom, until something jolts their system that says, I've had enough, I want to change, I don't want to live that way anymore. And that's what an intervention is we create the family dynamics to raise that bottom and have them feel that jolt.
So you have about a 98% success rate with Intervention 911?
Yes, to get them into treatment.
Now, how exactly does an intervention work?
Well, we gather as many people as possible. The most people that are there, the more successful the intervention is. You know, we want the family there, the employers there, anybody that loves and cares about that individual. Of course, every scenario, every situation is different because you know, for one family, we wouldn't want to invite an employer, say. You know, we don't want them to get fired over this. Mm-hmm. We want them to get treatment from this. So depending on what the relationship is like, then we would invite, you know, the employer, we'd invite a lawyer, we'd invite their doctor. You know, it just depends on who's connected to that person that could help guide them into treatment.
Okay. Say someone watching the show today thinks perhaps one of their loved ones has a problem with addiction. How would they start the process of an intervention?
You know, the first thing, I like that you say that, because a lot of the family members out there think that there's nothing they could do. They sit back and they feel hopeless. I worked with this one woman regarding her son, and she felt that, you know, if she was to do something, and she's already exhausted everything she can do. She helped get him arrested. She got the law involved. She did everything she could to try to get her son the help that he needed, and he was addicted to opiates. So what ended up happening is I educated her in a pre-intervention and told her, no, you do hold the power on helping him to get to treatment, and showed her ways to do that. This woman was in physical pain herself because she was so beaten down from what her son has done to her, where her son has, you know, hurt the behaviors of her son. She was so beaten down. And so what she finally did is when I educated her, she felt like she could run a marathon because she said, wow, there is something I could do. I don't have to sit back. I'm not helpless. There's something I could do to get my son into treatment.
So she had actually hit her bottom,
mm-hmm.
but the addict hadn't necessarily hit theirs yet. Is that something that normally takes place? The loved one hits their bottom before the addict or the alcoholic hits theirs?
Well, if you like you said earlier, 23 million Americans suffer from addiction. Mm-hmm. And I read it in one of the newspapers recently that only 1 million went into treatment last year. So that's a really low success or low rate of people seeking treatment on their own. So that means the other 22 million need our help. They need the assistance of their families to guide them into treatment. So it's not a negative thing. It just shows that the number one symptom of the disease of denial or of the disease of addiction is denial. So if that's the case, then how do we get the addict into treatment? So we bring the family members together and we help raise that bottom to jolt their system.
You mentioned 23 million Americans is the estimate that are addicts.
Hmm.
I've seen the statistics myself. In New York alone, the latest statistics that were put out in 2006 show that 1.8 million Americans were admitted for alcohol or drug addiction or a combination of both in the treatment facilities in the United States. Hmm. Now, New York alone accounted for over 300,000 of those people, or 17% of the 1.8 million people.
Mm-hmm.
So here in New York, there's an immediate problem that mm-hmm. needs to be addressed. Now, you mentioned denial, Ken. As far as the alcoholic or the addict in denial, do you run into circumstances where the families are also in denial?
Mm-hmm. Yep, and that's my goal, is to educate the families that there's something they could do. So what we want to look at is their behaviors that are causing them sleepless nights, you know, runs to the emergency room, runs to the jail cells. Is there examples that they have in their life that are creating trauma to them? And if there is, because of their loved one, then they are able to take the action necessary to save their loved one. And I believe that it really takes, because the family is the one that's coherent. The addict is numb. So I believe that it's the family's responsibility to step up to the plate, because number one, the addict's numb. Number two, the number one symptom of the disease of addiction is denial. So knowing those facts, then they're not gonna seek help until they hit that bottom and something happens to them. So if they're not gonna hit the bottom, and like you said, only 1.8 million get help out of 23 million, that means the family has to be the one